it's funny, isn't it, that when you watch children just giving their all, like those children were, it brings back into you, you know, just memories flood back about all the children you've ever worked with and all the children you've ever known. And it made me think particularly of Adam. And Adam taught me so many things, but I have one particular memory of Adam. He was one of those little boys that was never where he should be when he should be. And in exasperation one day, I went looking for him, and I found him in the bathroom with a little pot that he'd got from the sand. And he was concentrating deeply over this little pot, and he was mixing with a spoon. And I think I might have been slightly impatient. And I said to him, "Adam, what are you doing?" And he looked at me, and he said, "Mickey Bailey, I'm making a potion." He said, "It's a magic potion." And I felt guilty, and I said, "Oh, Adam, how interesting." I said, "Tell me, how did you make your potion?" And he looked at me, and he said, "I make it out of hot water and taupe." And then he proffered it, and he said, "Oh, try some." So, as we do, I took the potion, and I put it to my lips. And I said, "Oh, Adam, delicious." Whereupon he said, "Ha ha, it's poison." He said, "And now we'll die." So, there we go. And I'd like to spend this little bit of time up to coffee talking about creating the emotional climate for learning. Because I think it doesn't really matter how great your physical environment is. You can have the greatest physical environment in the world, but actually, if the emotional climate is not right, children's learning will never really flourish, and they will never really reach the potential that they could in an environment with that supportive emotional climate. And what I want to do is to talk about, you probably can go back to your training and think about Maslow and how, in terms of human needs, we all need food and warmth and shelter. But actually, if we're going to flourish, we need far more than that. And I'd like to talk about what I think are six needs that are really important for human beings. And I don't just mean for the children, I mean for all of us in our earlier settings. And if you're desperate for a cup of coffee, I'm only going to talk about six. So as I get towards them, you'll know that coffee's getting close. And here we go. The first thing I'd like to talk about is certainty. And I think that as human beings, we all need certainty in our lives. If you think about those of us working in earlier settings, we need to work for managers who have vision. We need to be strongly led. We need to be sure of where we're going. We need to know what will happen when. We need to know what to do when. And we actually need to have confidence that people will tell us the truth. And if you've ever doubted how important certainty is, just if you would think maybe to a time in your life when you've lacked certainty, when you weren't sure what was going to happen and how that made you feel. And I think about a time, if I can share this with you, and it might seem trivial, but I felt really uncertain. I'd been working at London University and I was going back to the train station to catch the train home. And I thought I'd cut off the corner and go through the park. And I don't know, and if anyone knows of me, you probably know I do a lot of work with puppets. So I got bagfuls of puppets with me. And I cut through the park, and I got to the gate at the other side. And when I got there, I found it was locked. And I thought, oh no, I'll have to walk all the way back and go right round, and I shouldn't have been so lazy in the first place. So I went back to the gate that I'd come in from, only to find that now was locked. And I was stuck in this large park in London with an 8-foot fence all around it, and strangely enough, nobody else about. So I thought, what do I do? So I got my phone and did the only thing I could think of doing, which was phoning the police. And I just, this is absolutely true, people think I make it up, but I don't. They put me through to Scotland Yard. So I begged with the man on the other end of the phone and said, please, believe me, I really am locked in Gordon Square Gardens. And he said, well, don't worry, madam, we'll send somebody around. Well, I waited for 45 minutes and it was now raining. And I felt extremely uncertain, and I felt even more uncertain when a large police car screeched up and two young policemen got out, and one of them said, Mrs. Bailey, I presume. And I nearly said, do you see anybody else? But I thought, it wasn't in my best interest. So the first thing they did was to try to force the gate. There's no way that gate was budging. And then they tried to lift a fence panel, and that wouldn't work either. And then I heard one say to the other, he said, I think it will have to be the fire brigade. So I said, oh, please, no. I said, if you could just find a stepladder, I'm sure I could get over. So they went off, and they came back about 10 minutes later with a stepladder, which they kind of threw over the fence. And then one of the policemen came over and manhandled all my bags over. And then he propped the stepladder up the side and he said, OK, now if you can get to the top, he said, then we'll help you. So I scrambled to the top and I was sitting on top of this 8-foot fence. And by now, a small crowd had gathered. And I looked down and the policeman kindly said, he said, you can jump now, madam. So I said to him, are you sure? I'm a very big woman. You might wonder where this is going, but these two policemen manhandled me down to the applause of the assembled crowd. I sloped off with my bag of puppets to the station. And my feelings at that point were all over the place. And it's just that, like, when you're in, and that's quite a trivial situation, but some of us have been in situations where not having certainty has been far more profoundly affecting than that one. But it's just about getting us to think, if we can, about how do we provide certainty for the children in our settings. And I love this little picture here of this little boy who goes to a nursery setting where I live, and his little sister, who comes every day with him and is always certain of a warm welcome. She knows she can't stay, but she knows that she can stay for a while while he settles in. And she knows that that routine each day is going to be the same. And she has absolute certainty that the staff in that setting will meet her needs. And it's interesting, isn't it? I was in a setting some time ago, and you may be able to work this out, but there's a little tiny girl, maybe 2.5, and she kept going to the practitioner and grabbing her. And she would say, sit on the green chair. Sit on the green chair. And then a little bit later, she'd do it again. Sit on the green chair. Sit on the green chair. And she hadn't settled very well, this little girl. And I finally realized where she was coming from. Because when it was time for all the carers and the mummies to come, the practitioner sat on the green chair and read a story. And so the little girl thought if she could get the practitioner to sit on the green chair, her mummy would come. And I just kept thinking, you know, children have no abstract concept of time. And if only that setting had had maybe a little pictorial timetable so that they could have shown her, well, this is going to happen, and then that will happen, and then this will happen, and then mummy will come. And that might have just given her that little bit of certainty. And I think the home corner is a place where many young children find certainty. Now, just a little few images to share. And, you know, I think you can tell from practice practitioner's body language. You know, that practitioner there is there for the child. The child knows that that practitioner is there for her. And she is certain, you know, that whatever happens, that practitioner will be there. You can tell just by the body language, whether the way that practitioner works, down at the level of the children, supporting them, reveling in the joy of their learning. It's, I know we all get days when, you know, we might feel a little bit off. And, you know, we've got to allow that in ourselves as well, because we're not robots. You know, we're going to have our off days. But for most days, it's just such a privilege. It's, I know you don't do it for the money, because the money's not good, is it? But, the joy of working with young children is perhaps the biggest reward we get. Being interested in the things that interest them. Providing that security. I mean, this is interesting, this little girl here. There were some little boys that were playing, they were role-playing the story of the three little pigs. And she was getting a little bit scared. And the practitioner had a slight dilemma. She didn't want to squash the play of these boys, but she also didn't want the little girl to be scared. So I watched this happen, and she gently put her arm round her and reassured her, and then everything was fine. So we are there for the children. Again, another lovely picture, a lovely image that says, you know, I'm interested in what you're interested in. I'm here to support you. You know, I want to be part of your learning. But now I've got a question for you as I go to my second need. What happens when you get absolutely certain about what's going to happen and when it's going to happen? You get bored. So, not only do we need certainty in our lives, and this might seem a bit of a contradiction, but actually we also need uncertainty. We need excitement, surprise and variety. We need to be able to make mistakes and take risks. And that's not just the children, that's us as well. In our work with them, we need to stretch ourselves. We need to take ourselves to the limits, to try new things. And if they go wrong, to forgive ourselves. You know, if we make a mistake, have we failed? No, we have simply got a result or an outcome. And if you think about it, now I always think about Edison. It's like it's memory at my age. You forget names, you forget. You know, I am the woman that goes into the kitchen and thinks, why am I here? And then I realise I've gone for my omega-3 tablets. But the worst thing I ever did, actually I'll share this with you, the worst thing I ever did was on a train last year. I saw this gentleman and I thought, I know him. I know that gentleman. Now where do I know him from? Where do I know him from? And eventually when it came to me, I blurted it out. And I said, I've got it. I know where I know you from. I said, you were the father of one of my children. Train's going, oh! And I'm trying to cover my back. I say, no, not like that. I'm a teacher. You know, your little boy was in my class. But it was too late. The damage was done. You know. So it's actually Edison I was thinking about. When Edison was inventing the light bulb, a friend of his said, look, you've had 1,000 attempts to make this light bulb work, and 1,000 times you failed. Why don't you just give up? And Edison replied, no, he said, I have not failed. I have simply identified 1,000 ways in which it will not work. And isn't that what we're about? You know, in our work with children, you know, if children are shy and very withdrawn, we try way after way after way of bringing them out until we find a way that works. If children have got problems with behaviour or emotional difficulties. We try strategy after strategy after strategy, and we don't give up until we find one that works. So we need excitement, surprise and variety, and so do children, don't they? You know, they need settings that are full of curiosity, wonder and puzzlement. You know, it's curiosity, wonder and puzzlement that are key to keeping children interested and making them want to know more about the world in which they find themselves. Just a couple of images. Some children there exploring shadows with a great big sheet. It's the old shaving foam. And you can see why forest schools have become so, people are so interested in them, because they give the children opportunities for, you know, immense surprise, risk-taking, you know, wonder, puzzlement. And Philomena was talking about the importance of the outdoors. And I once listened to a lady from Finland, and she put me to shame. I mean, Philomena said, you know, there's no such thing as bad weather, only inadequate clothing. But this lady really put me to shame when she said, we do not take children outside if temperature fall below minus 15. So there we go. I mean, isn't this the essence of childhood? You know, if you think about the things we did with mud pies, daisy chains, and petal perfume. Just a few images there. Curiosity, wonder, and puzzlement. Sometimes that little bit of uncertainty. And how about that? You know, that's not expensive, is it? But probably, certainly in England, to do that we would have to have done our risk assessments. But children need to take risks. It's true. This is a setting in County Durham in the north of England called Wingate Children's Centre. And there they let the children take, obviously, sensible risks. You know, risks that have been thought through. Because what they realise is that there are benefits to risk. And that, you know, if we are going to create a climate where children flourish, they've got to be able to take risks. Tim Gill, I don't know if anyone's come across the book he's just written, No Fear, Living in a Risk-Adverse Society. He says that, you know, encounters with risk help children to learn how to manage risks, that they have an appetite for risk, and that if it's not fed, they will actually seek out situations in which they may be exposed to even greater risks. You probably haven't got this in your handouts because I slipped it in later, but it's some Tim Gill, No Fear. You know, he says that there are benefits to risk, benefits to health, developmental benefits, that when children take risks, reasonably well thought through risks, they face up to adverse circumstances. They know there's the possibility of injury. I don't know where the hyphen came in, it's my typing. But you know, it helps them to become adventurous, resilient and self-reliant. And actually, if we stop them taking risks, that does nothing for their overall well-being. We've got to think it through, but they've got to be allowed to take risks. Perhaps not quite like that.
Thank you.
learning is more fundamental to solid educational development than a pure, uncontaminated curiosity. So we need certainty. We need uncertainty. And we need significance. We all need self-esteem and recognition, to be consulted, to be listened to, and to know that our voice will be heard. And we all need to feel successful. And we have in England at the moment, we have a culture of push where everything is tested. And I walked into a class of 4 and 5 year olds last year, and I was I was very saddened when I sat down by a little boy and I said to him, I'm Roz. Like, you know how sometimes the children, they tap you, and sometimes they get it wrong, and they go, Mum, they don't ever do that with me now, it's Nana. But I said to him, I'm Roz, and he said, I'm Daniel. And then he said to me, I'm Daniel, and I'm a banana. So then he said, he pointed to a little girl on a different part of the room. He said, that's Stacy. He said, she's my best friend. He said, she's a pineapple. He said, I'd like to be a pineapple. Because if I was a pineapple, I could be with Stacy. And I thought I knew the answer, but I said, well, Daniel, why can't you be a pineapple? And he looked at me and he said, I haven't got enough ticks to be a pineapple. So I tried to be encouraging and I said, well, yes, but actually, Daniel, there's lots of weeks left. Maybe you'll get more ticks and then you can be a pineapple and you can be with Stacy. And he looked at me doubtfully, but then he pointed to some other children and he said, mind you, he said, I've got more ticks than they have. He said, they're the Satsumas. But really and truly, it's so sad, isn't it? I just like at this point to say that these needs are so great that they've got to be met. And if they're not met positively, they'll be met negatively. Because they're that strong. And sometimes the children that are the most difficult to like are the ones that actually most need us to support them to be significant. Maybe, you know, they've never been significant at anything other than winding the practitioner up, being the worst in the group, doing the naughtiest things. Maybe they don't have significance or identity in any other way, but I'm the bestest at being the naughtiest. And they get their identity that way. It's like Philomena was saying, it's switching it, isn't it? You know, to that can-do, positive culture. And I'd just like to read you, if I may, a little piece from an article that was published in the Times Educational Supplement a few years ago. It was a great friend of mine who sadly died about 3 years ago. And she was a great, great early years teacher. And she wrote this. And it goes like this. It's very short. The ordinary boy who wasn't. And this is from my friend Annabel Dixon. It was my first term of teaching, and I was amazed at how different five-year-olds could be from one another. Some were full of curiosity. Others were particularly creative. And there were others still who, much as I liked them, I found rather ordinary. They seldom did anything interesting, and they were inhibited about trying any of the exciting things I was bringing in. At discussion time, they rambled on about their grand's neighbour's new pups, or, in David's case, the duckling he'd been given. One day, David said he wanted to share something at discussion time. I knew he'd go on for hours, but I agreed, hoping he'd forget. All day, he kept reminding me of my promise, but discussion time that day had to be cancelled. Later, in the melee of home time, I heard a loud sobbing coming from the classroom door. David had his arms spread-eagled across the door facing the class. "You've all got to listen! My duck died last night!" He then dissolved into loud tears. I was mortified and ashamed as I realised I'd probably have found time for him if he'd been one of the more articulate children. Shortly afterwards, a friend asked me to a lecture by someone recently returned from Africa. He talked about working alongside people so different from himself and how difficult he'd found it, until he realised that just liking them wasn't enough. To love them, he had first to accept them as individuals. As he spoke, I saw David and his kind in the classroom, children I hadn't truly accepted for the essential, unique human beings they were. It wasn't the clever children who changed the way I talked and saw children. It was brave, ordinary David. He helped me to take that first step towards valuing each and every child by accepting them for their uniqueness and not for being better at schoolwork than others. If you think about it, think about somebody who maybe feels no significance, and think about maybe a young offender who is holding a gun to somebody's head and attempting to rob them. I know that none of us would condone that, but if you think about it, for the moment that that young offender is holding a gun at somebody's head, is he significant? Oh yes. And sometimes we'll meet children that, because they can't find significance in negative ways, in positive ways, we'll try. They'll do it in any way they can because these needs are so strong. That little boy spent a whole morning making a little house for a little soft toy, and he was very proud of it. So another little one there exploring shadows. Just some little images. You know, when children feel that they can go and explore that environment with certainty, you know, that the practitioners are there to support them, you know, they feel significant. When they have ownership of that environment and they operate with those adults in a climate of shared control. I love the concentration. And I just think this is a really nice little piece. I know you can read it yourself, but you must learn that you cannot be loved by all people. You can be the finest apple in the world, ripe, juicy, succulent, and offer yourself to all. But you must remember there are people who do not like apples. You must understand that if you are the world's finest apple and someone you love does not like apples, you have a choice of becoming a banana. But you must be warned that if you choose to become a banana, you will be a second-rate banana. But you will always be the finest apple. You must also realize that if you choose to be a second-rate banana, there will be people who do not like bananas. Furthermore, you can spend your life trying to become the best banana, which is impossible if you are an apple, or you can seek again to be the finest apple. And I think that's what, sorry about my fruit theme today, but I think that's what we're trying to do for all children that we work with, to help them to be their own very best unique self. And I think that should also apply not just to them, but to us as well. Need 4, connection and love. We all need positive relationships, to know that we matter to others, to have our feelings acknowledged. And we all need connection to the natural and wider world. And again, if I can tell a story from my work with children. I had a little girl in my group once, maybe Amy was three, and hadn't settled very well. And she cried every day until Diljit came. And they became the best of friends, and Amy and Diljit went everywhere together and did everything together. And Amy stopped crying until one day Diljit didn't come. And Amy began to cry. And maybe I hadn't been very patient, but I didn't appear to be able to stop her crying. And then I watched Daniel, little boy, 4 and a half, in my group. Daniel got up, he went across to her, he took her hand, and he said, "Amy," he said, "you're upset, aren't you, because Diljit's not here today. He said, would you like me to play with you?" And he did what I had failed to do. He acknowledged her feelings. And because she felt that her feelings had been acknowledged, she stopped crying and off they went together. And it was very humbling, because it really did that day put me to shame. So we all need connection. We all need someone that will go that extra mile for us. And isn't it about role models? I think about Daniel, and why was he so good with Amy? And I had to look no further than his mum and his dad. And he had actually done what he had seen them do many times before. And I'm just struck by how, you know, children become the people they spend their time with. And if you've ever doubted it, you've only got to watch them pick a book up. I don't have a book, but they hold it. They sit on our chair. They hold the book, just like we do. And if you look, they have our mannerisms off. And I was actually with one practitioner last year who said, she was absolutely shocked. She said, "You know, I never realised how much the children watched and listened and looked until one day one of them sat on my chair, picked up a book, just like I do, and said, 'Right, story.'" She said, "I never even realised I hitched up my bra strap when I sat down." She said, "And the children were copying it." And another very profound example of this was in a class of 4 and 5 year olds, there were two adults doing a movement lesson, and the children were moving all around the school hall to music. And one of the practitioners that was working with them was a big lady. And I don't think she realised she was doing it, but as she joined in and she ran around the school hall with the children, she was doing this. which in itself is probably quite sensible, because you don't want to be chafed. But the whole point of this is that when I looked, and this is absolutely true, 27 children were running round that school hall, holding their chests. Now, I know it's a kind of fairly flippant story, but the message behind it is really, really powerful. We are so important as role models for those children. Their connection with us, you know, we have such impact on them. You'll be pleased to know I'm coming up to the next need, so we're getting closer to coffee. Oh, can I just tell you about this lady who... This lady retired this year, and she's just a brilliant nursery officer. And this tiny little girl is in a very, very deprived setting. And this tiny little girl here, who was desperate to fold up this very large piece of mark making she'd done and couldn't do it. You know, the way that the connection between this practitioner and the little child, as she gently leans over and supports her to do it for herself. She could so easily have taken it off her and done it for her, but she didn't. You know, she just gently leaned over. And that connection with the wider world. And talking about connection and how important it is, you know, if you think about maybe, you know, an adolescent who joins a gang, you know, maybe quite a violent gang, why would they want to do that? Well, there's probably quite a lot of reasons, but one might just have something to do with connection. You know, it might not be a very positive connection, but if you're part of a gang, you've got connection. Like an elderly person who maybe doesn't want to get up in the morning, has outlived all their peers, doesn't see a lot of point in life anymore, and then suddenly somebody buys them a puppy or a kitten, and they've got a purpose, they've got a connection, they get up in the morning, they've got something that matters to them and something that they matter to. Hugely important. I love that picture. I don't know who wrote this, but I know it was written by a child. I don't have a name, but isn't it great? When you are sad, I will dry your tears. When you are scared, I will comfort your fears. When you are worried, I will give you hope. When you are confused, I will help you to cope. And when you are lost and can't see the light, I shall be your beacon shining ever so bright. This is my oath I pledge till the end. Why, you may ask? Because you're my friend. And I think many, many children see us like that. It's to be hoped they do. Growth. We all need to feel part of a learning community. We all need new challenges. And we all need awareness and self-knowledge. And that's one of the lovely things about The Colour of My Dreams and the emphasis it puts on supporting children to gain that awareness of themselves and others and self-knowledge. And it's like feelings, isn't it? If you think about the word emotion, emotion is an energy and it's got to go somewhere. And if our feelings are not acknowledged, they can go one of two ways, like all energy. It's either got to implode and we take it inside as maybe guilt or resentment, or it explodes as anger and aggression. So, you know, so important. That awareness and that self-knowledge. So it's just really about asking ourselves, how are we helping our children to grow? But also, what are we doing to help ourselves to grow? Because it's a really important human need. And these ladies here had got really fairly negative attitudes to education. And it was their children that persuaded them to come into the nursery setting and try some activities like glass painting. And when they came in and they tried it, the staff had tried to get them in and failed. So they'd said to the children, see if you can get your mummies to come. And they did. And they loved it. And it was great. You know, growth, we all need to stretch ourselves. You know, it doesn't have to cost a lot of money, does it either? Look at that. I love it. Cardboard boxes, dust sheets, offcuts of wood, crates and gaffer tape, and you can construct and make great things. This was lovely. This little boy, I was in a setting where they'd made a kind of hole under the sea world, and the staff caught him one day doing that. So they provided extra resources. We all need to stretch ourselves. Don't be afraid to take a big step if one is indicated. You can't cross a chasm in two small jumps. Just thought I'd throw that one in. And finally, contribution. We all need to be part of a group and feel that we can make a contribution to that group. We all need appropriate responsibility to be able to show that we care and mutual support. And I think that's really important. If you think about yourself in your setting, and think about yourself as a role model for the children, how do you deal with difficulties and conflicts when they arise? How do you make a contribution? And you see, it strikes me that there are three sorts of people in life. And you might describe them as energy givers, energy drainers, and energy neutral people. You've got your energy givers. You know, those people that are always up for it, they'll always have a go, they'll always try it out, they'll always stretch themselves, they'll always contribute. Then the energy drainers, you know. Oh, you know, we tried that in 1972. You know, it didn't work then. You know. And then you've got your energy neutral people that sort of become energy givers if they're with energy givers, but become energy drainers if they're with energy drainers. So I'd like you just to take a moment to think about where you are on that continuum. Because children need energy givers, not just because they'll catch that from them and become energy givers themselves, but because, you know, it's energy givers that create great settings that are not just physically exciting, but also have that safe emotional climate. Those children hatch those little ducks themselves from in an incubator, and they looked after them so tenderly, so gently, and so responsibly. Some children here making snack for the rest of the setting. Making their own dough. Making a contribution. A snack in the forest school. Great achievements are nurtured with the cooperation of many minds working towards a common goal. And Ferrelavers, some of you will know the work of Professor Ferrelavers. He gives these indicators of well-being, saying that, you know, I'm not going to read them out, but saying that if a child is in a really good state of well-being, a high level of well-being, that child will be like a fish in water. It's in that state of flow. And I'll finish with this. Perhaps the most important single cause of a person's success or failure educationally has to do with the question of what he or she believes about themselves. And I really believe that. I believe, I know it's a bit of an old cliche, but in the words of Henry Ford, whether you believe you can, or whether you believe you can't, you are absolutely right. So thank you so much and enjoy your coffee.